So this is a slightly different format. We asked for some questions. We did get a couple of questions, but I'm happy to take any questions as we go along. We have both myself on the line and Daniel, who knows a lot more about the details of MPI than I do. My experience is much more sort of application side. So I'll just say this is the MPI Q&A session, and all these slides aren't particularly interesting, but they're on the Creative Commons and such like. So the overview, as I said, the idea for this was twofold. One was based on the observation here. I said learning the basic MPI syntax is relatively straightforward. It's maybe like going on a C programming course. If you want to learn C, there's only the C only has a few dozen pieces of syntax to it. But then there's a lot more questions that arise. You learn send, receive, init, com size, com rank, stuff like that. When you actually want to write a real application, then things get more complicated. But there is a lot of experience in the community about how to do various things. Typical things that people immediately ask is things about how avoiding deadlock, overlapping communication calculation, debugging is always an issue, parallel IO comes up. That was just a few things which I thought of and want to get real questions from you and ask them. So we did get a couple of questions in advance. So I'm just trying to slightly resize my my windows here. A slightly strange view. Fine. So somebody submitted a question here, which was, and it's actually been a very interesting question. If you need to send multiple arrays with lengths that vary with each send, is it better to use MPI pack as opposed to creating a structure with the MPI type create struct command? In both instances, in the send message, you can specify the actual lengths of the different arrays to be sent. Well, there's a slight So this is a problem. So they're saying that each time you you come around to a particular point in the code, you need to send multiple arrays that have presumably to the same destination with different lengths. So of course you could just copy them all together into a buffer, send them and unpack them at the other end. But MPI provides functionality called MPI pack, where you basically have a setup phase where you call MPI functions to pack data into a buffer. Then you send the buffer and you unpack it at the other side. So that's a single message. But what I think the user here is pointing out that you could create like a spanning structure, where you have a structure which has a pointer on, which points to the first array and how long it is, the second array and how long it is, the third array and how long it is, and then send that object as a single single block. I think there's a problem here. There's a number of issues here. The problem with creating the struct is that it's not quite true you specify the actual length of different arrays to be sent. Well, you have to specify that when you create the structure. The structure says, I've got an array of so many doubles, and another array of so many ints, or another array of so many doubles. That's encoded in the definition of the structure. Secondly, if the structure contains pointers to the buffers, you're not going to send the structures. You're going to send the actual pointers. So, in fact, the approach of using a structure, I don't think you can. I think you're going to have to do a manual copy. I would have thought you'd have to copy them all in. It hadn't occurred to me. So, I mean, it does depend on the various, because you could send multiple messages. I mean, if they're very, very big, then sending multiple messages isn't such a bad idea because you'll amortize the latency. But if you do want to send a single message, then MPI pack is probably a reasonable thing to do. It's not something I've done myself in the past, but I think that's why MPI pack, and the reason that we don't typically use MPI pack is that's in the old days, well, there's a very, very old message passing system called PVM, parallel virtual machine, where the modus operandi was pack buffer, send buffer, unpack, because it didn't really understand data types. You were sending bytes all the time. MPI tries to get away from that model, tries to let you just say, look, I want to send this array and there's five integers, and there's not the explicit buffer packing step. But there are situations where it can be useful, and this is probably one of them. I don't know if Daniel should be able to talk. I don't know, if, but I mean, I hadn't actually thought about the shallow deep copy issue. If you have a structure with pointers to the arrays and you send the structure, you'll just send the pointers, not the arrays. So you're going to have to do a manual copy to do that, which possibly possibly means you have as many issues as doing the pack. I don't know. I know Daniel's given this a bit more thought than me. So Daniel, you should be able to just click the talk button because you're a moderator. But
So can you hear me? Yes, maybe, possibly. Good. Okay. So yeah, the as David was saying, the pack and unpack functions in MPI are really included for backwards compatibility and compatibility with previous libraries before MPI. And so in general, you don't use them, that they aren't used. You should use the data types, the derived data types. So the instruction whenever teaching MPI is always to use the type create struct command in this sort of instance. But there are actually more considerations than that. So it's there's quite a few aspects that you would have to consider before you actually realize which one was fastest or possibly best in your situation. My instinct would be that the derived data types should be better than using the MPI packed method. But actually in practice, it would depend on many factors. It includes the size of each array, the type of each array element, whether those arrays were contiguous in memory or whether they were non-contiguous, and also whether the data representation was homogeneous or heterogeneous between the two machines that you're sending. So each of those could make the decision for you in its, in its own right. But actually, the combination of those is what you really want to consider for this particular case. So if the size of each piece is really small, then the amount of time it would take to actually copy the data into a contiguous buffer is going to be quite small, and therefore it's probably going to be smaller than the time it would take to commit a derived data type. And so for performance reasons, you would probably do the copying yourself manually. But obviously, the greater the size of the amount of data that you're actually copying, the longer the data copy would take, and therefore maybe MPI could do the packing, the data copying bit more efficiently than you could. And so you would tell MPI to pack in that case. So that's sort of there is a trade-off here between you doing the operation yourself in code. Or telling MPI how to do the operation and getting MPI to do it for you. I think the last point is one that is often missed. The representation of the data. MPI, if you give it a derived data type, will convert the representation of those data types between two different machines. So if, for example, MPI int or MPI double were different sizes on two different machines and you were sending from one to the other, MPI will handle that size difference and switch the representation so that the same value is represented in the receiving machine. But if you pack it yourself, then you would pack, for example, 8 bytes on one machine and you'd unpack it and try and fit that into a 4-byte quantity at the other end. They'd both be double precision floating point, for example. But if the representation is a different size, then you have to handle that sort of thing yourself. So in that case, it might be simpler. It would be very much simpler code to allow MPI to just do that itself. And you might make the determination that in order to get simple code, you would sacrifice a bit of performance. So this is actually quite a subtle question. It's not obvious what the answer is. There isn't a single, you should use X answer to this question.
Thanks, Daniel. That was very useful. Does anyone else have any comments on that? I don't know if anyone's encountered something like this before or And the normal case I've encountered it is that you have to send, at each iteration, you have to send lots of messages with different sizes, but you're often sending them to different destinations. You might be doing halo swapping in a molecular dynamics code where you need to send halo particles up, down, left, right, forward, backwards. So at each iteration, you don't know how many you're sending, but you're sending one message to each recipient, in which case MPI pack doesn't help you. But if you're sending multiple messages to the same recipient, if you can manually pack them to send a single message. So I think as Daniel was saying, it's the question of what's the overhead of the packing and paying the cost of one latency for the send versus the latency of sending multiple messages. So it is interesting. Okay, so I'll just move on to the, I'm slightly struggling with the interface here. The second question was, I have an application that uses OpenMP and can run in a shared memory environment, multi-core, single node, etc. How difficult is it to implement MPI in such an application? I.e. creating a hybrid OpenMP MPI application, can I build on what I have or do I need to go back to square one? So that's a very interesting question. So the normal question that people ask is, I have an MPI application, I'm going to run it on a machine like Archer, which is a clustered shared memory model. So each node has 24 cores sharing memory. And the normal question is, should I just run 24 MPI processes per node, or can I include OpenMP? And maybe come back to this is a different one. So I think that the point is, unfortunately, MPI is a very, very different parallelization model. So because it's distributed memory. So if you want two processes to access the same data, they have to act physically, explicitly communicate with each other. Whereas in OpenMP, you can have shared arrays, and you can have the luxury of different threads. Sorry, I seem to have picked up a bit of a cold. You have the luxury of different threads reading and writing to the same array. So I think, unfortunately, the answer here is that what you'd have to do is go back and you say create a hybrid OpenMP MPI application. I think probably what you would do is go back and the difficulty would be writing the MPI part. So the easiest thing to do would probably be to write, sorry, the straightforward thing to do, I'm not saying it's easy, but the linear route would be to go back to your program and rewrite it in MPI. You may be able to reuse some of the concepts you did with your OpenMP parallelization. You understand what parts of the program can be done independently, what parts require some collaboration, which might require synchronization in OpenMP, but you're probably going to have to rewrite it. Then you'll have a pure OpenMP program and a pure MPI program, and then the question is, do you want to reintroduce OpenMP into the MPI program? And that's quite a subtle question. It's not always advantageous to do that. So I think, unfortunately, you have to effectively, from a coding standpoint, you have to go back to square one and re-implement the whatever your problem is in MPI. You may get a head start because you've already thought and analyzed the problem with a parallel mindset, and you may be able to do that quite quickly. But I think what you'd get would get a pure MPI program, and I would guess. My money would be on then adding OpenMP back into the MPI problem code isn't possible. You need to think carefully about whether it's worth doing that for a number of reasons. So that was an interesting question. That's an interesting question. So I think the answer is, the general state is writing an MPI program is harder than OpenMP, but if you've got a hunch that you're on a shared memory machine, but you might want to take, that there's a good chance you might want to take it further in the future, starting off with MPI might be a good thing to do. It then gives you the option to grow. Although it's harder to do the MPI program, once you've written it, going beyond a single shared memory node, multi-core node, is trivial because the MPI model is distributed memory from square one. So that was an interesting question, again, and I think it's not the one that people normally ask. But I think, yes, you have to spectrally, from a coding standpoint, go back to square one.
Yeah. I think one of the comments I would make there is that it's common for an OpenMP program to use a fork join model of parallelism, where the a single thread branches into multiple threads for a particular loop and then joins back into a single thread, does some code, and then does branches again for another loop. And that is exactly not what MPI does. The MPI processes persist for the entire length of the program. And so it would be equivalent, the programming model would be equivalent to starting your OpenMP region at the beginning of your program and ending it at the end of your program and never doing this fork join in between. So if you can transform your OpenMP program so that there is only one parallel region and extends for the entire length of your program, then you are much closer to the way that MPI views the world, much closer to the programming model of MPI. That program would probably be easier to write it again in MPI because each of the threads that you've got at least has a continuous execution from the beginning of the program to the end of the program. The fork join, you would naturally want to try and write that if you were trying to exactly copy it. You would naturally want to try and use some of the dynamic processing features of MPI, which are rarely used and aren't always supported on big machines like Archer, for example, doesn't support the spawn or spawn multiple aspects of MPI. And so you would have to rewrite not just the directives, the OpenMP directives into MPI functions somehow. You would also have to change the programming model, the approach to parallelism in the code, which is a much more fundamental change.
Thanks, Dan. So I can pull up a few slides which are sort of effectively answer my own questions. The ones, but I'd be very. Does anyone have any? I see there's quite a few. There's a dozen or so people on the call. Does anyone have any questions of any level they want to ask about MPI, which we could, me and Dan could try and answer? Okay, so the question is, can you send an unsigned 64-bit integer in MPI? I've heard that the unsigned long int MPI data type is typically not found. That's a good question. I mean, I'll give my hacky answer initially, because I know that Dan knows much about the standard. If you're on a homogeneous architecture where you know, like Archer, where you know all the participating processes are running in the same environment, the same operating system, the same hardware, then if you send 64, as long as you send 64 bits from one side to the other, then you're fine. So, you know, you could just send any type which you knew was 64 bits long would correctly transfer the data because the bits that it sent on the left, so you could send it as 8 bytes, for example. However, MPI really tries to get away from this from sending bytes. It wants you to send data types. It wants you to send one, you know, long int rather than 8 bytes, and that's for two reasons. A, it's much more elegant in your code to say send one long int, and secondly, as Dan mentioned in the previous answer, in principle, if you send MPI types, if the representation on the two ends is different, then it will be converted correctly because it will be interpreted correctly on both sides. But as to the availability of the long int MPI data, I don't know it. Dan, do you know anything about that?
So in order to call itself MPI compliant, an MPI library must support certain data types. So if the types don't exist, then it's not actually MPI standard compliant, would be the standards approach, the standard answer to the question. So the other thing to consider is that, yes, there's an MPI unsigned long type, which is probably what you want, but there's also an MPI uint64_t type, which is an unsigned integer 64-bit type. It matches to the C uint64t type. So both of those should be capable of transmitting that value, that type of data. And you may find that one exists and one doesn't exist. But actually, technically, the MPI library isn't standards compliant, or at least isn't compliant with the various version that defines that value, that type. if it doesn't actually define it in its MPI.h file.
Because that is an interesting question, actually. So, as I said, my hacky answer would be, if you can't find an exact match, any MPI on a homogeneous architecture, which most modern systems are, mm-hmm. anything which sends 64 bits is going to be okay. For example, I think that, is it not, MPI doesn't have, does MPI have double complex? That's the Fortran programmer's gripe off used to be that it doesn't have double complex.
I guess one of the other possible answers to this question is Fortran doesn't have unsigned integer types in the language, and so you can't store such a value in Fortran because Fortran doesn't have such a thing. So MPI can't send it because it doesn't exist. You can store the bit pattern that C would interpret as an unsigned, 64-bit quantity in a 64-bit sized chunk of memory, but Fortran won't interpret it as an unsigned value. It would interpret it as a signed value, and it would be large and negative if it used that extra bit, the signed bit. And so if this question is actually from somebody who's coding in Fortran, then the answer is there is no such thing in Fortran. And so that's why MPI can't do it.
But I assumed it was a C question, so I said yes. I should.
I assumed, and I shouldn't have done it.
So does GNK, does that help? I okay, thanks. Are there any other questions? I said really any question at all is you can ask anything you want about Archer or MPI, or as I said, if not, I can go on some slides which I think might be of general interest, which sort of mention some of the things which I alluded to in my description for the session. I mean, maybe one thing I did have a few slides here which I'll maybe just bring up. Please type in any questions you have while I get going. So a question which always comes up is overlapping communications and calculation. And this is something which it's a bit like mixing MPI and OpenMP. A lot of people have an MPI code and they think, I can exploit the shared memory nature of the Archer nodes, for example, and they'll spend a long time putting OpenMP into their code, so they have a hybrid MPI OpenMP code, and then they find it doesn't go any faster. So, again, overlapping communications and calculation is something you really need to think about, because people could often put a lot of effort into structuring their code so that it appears to overlap communication and calculation, or has the ability to, but in practice they don't get any performance benefit. So I'll maybe come back to that, but just to say, my basic example here is, I just ripped these from a course I give, so some of them, whoops, take not the words may, but imagine you've got a typical Halo swapping code, and when I say EGMPP course, this is for our MSc students, but it's a simple 2D code which has Halo swapping and up, down, left, right. One of the things you do want to do with MPI is not impose ordering. So you really want to let MPI, in some senses, overlap the communications with itself. So what the easiest way to write Halo swapping is send up, receive down, send down, receive up, for example. That would actually, one thing. And then you're going to have to do send left, receive right, send right, receive left, if you had a 2D problem. Now, of course, you're going to have to you're going to have to avoid deadlock, but you could do that with non-blocking send receive, or you could actually just do that with send receive. But actually, one of the better things to do, but what you're doing there is that you're imposing, in this case, you're imposing that the up send receive should complete before the down. So you're saying, right, I'm going to do the Halo swaps up the way, and I'm going to wait for them to the finish, and do the Halo swaps down the way and wait for them to finish, and then do the Halo swaps right and the Halo swaps left, and wait for them to finish in turn. The bad thing about that is you might be doing a Halo swap up the way, which requires a receive from the guy up the way, but the person to your left or right might be sitting there. They might be running a bit fast. They might be ready to to communicate with you. And so in general, imposing order in the communications pattern is not a good thing to do unless if it's not required for correctness. So actually, what might be quite good is to actually do something on the right, which is loop over all directions, do a non-blocking send up and a non-blocking receive down, a non-blocking send down, a non-blocking receive up, and then the same in a 2D problem for left and right, and then just do MPI wait. So basically, spawn off all the non-blocking communications and just, you know, up, send up, receive up, send out, get them all going, and then do a wait. And that allows MPI is then waiting on a whole bunch of outstanding communications, and it allows MPI to process them, deal with them as they come in. So, you know, this, as a user, imposing an order on the effectively arbitrary order on the communications is not a good thing to do. It's much better to get everything going and then let MPI sort it out in the background. Now, this is when you start doing this, you start to have to ask questions about message ordering. But in general, the way MPI works, things will match correctly because MPI matches messages in the order they were sent, even with the non-blocking communications. And then now what people say is, oh, well, we can overlap communication with the core calculation. You know, I can start swapping the halos, but basically a lot of the calculation can often be done without that without receiving. What they're saying is, do you start the halo swap here? Can you see my cursor? Does my cursor appear? I don't see exactly what you see as a student. Can somebody see me as an attendee? Can somebody see me wiggling my cursor there? Because I can't. But you can. Fine. Thanks. I can't see it. But so, in between the end loop and the wait, you can say, well, there's a whole bunch of calculation I can do in here. So this is sort of saying, let MPI overlap calculations with other calculations. Let it just deal with them. But then you can say, well, as a user, I can do stuff in here. So what you say is, if I have an array, what I could say is I don't have a diagram for that. No, I don't. Well, what you would normally do, what you could say here is you could start sending these boundary values, which is the halo swap. You could then process, if you've got a calculation which only requires up, down, left, right, nearest neighbor communications, you then say, well, then let's process this core region, this 4x4 region. Then after halo swap is finished, this data has come in. This data has come in, and I can then tidy up the calculation around here. So you have a two-phase calculation. You say, start sending these halos, that's the boundary data, do the communication which doesn't depend on the halos, receive the halos, and then finish the calculation around the edge. And that all seems very, very attractive, and it looks nice. But in practice, it rarely benefits, because if you think about it, the model is this magic thing called MPI, which does the communication for you. But if actually MPI has to run somewhere, MPI has to run on a processor. MPI has to, when you call the MPI library, it has to go away and do stuff. And so, in practice, in most situations, this doesn't work. I mean, you can try enable it on the Cray. There's a mode in MPI on the Cray where you can get it to. They're called asynchronous progress threads. You can say to MPI, keep chugging along in the background, even, you know, all the time. But again, there are overheads with that and such like. So, I mean, what would I say? If you're going to try and overlap communications and calculations, my advice is always, first of all, you know, is there really enough calculation to overlap that will make a benefit to your overall performance? If you think it will, only do it if the programming effort is tractable, not if it kills the entire code. And then always make sure you can switch it in and out, so that on any system you can basically time the two and see which is better. Because actually the overlapping can actually the extra logic you need to do, which is process this stuff and then wait and then process this stuff, that twiddling around rather than just saying process all this stuff in a one-er can actually slow your program down. So I often see codes which have overlapping communications calculation in them. I'm often not convinced that code will be faster than the naive implementation. So there are any, the next thing you might say is, well, rather than swapping halos every iteration, swap halos compute, why don't I use deep halos? So what you say here is, well, every other iteration, I swap a halo of depth 2, which allows me to swap a halo of depth 2, do two computation phases locally, then swap a halo of depth 2, do two computation phases locally. That sounds attractive because you're trading off latency and bandwidth. You're sending twice the data, but you're sending it half as frequently. So you're sending half as many messages. So that immediately sounds quite attractive. There's some replicated calculation. It may not be obvious, but there's some replicated calculation. But it sounds quite attractive. But actually, it has a major downside because if you look at this diagram, you need communication from your. If you do two computation phases, even with a 5-point stencil where you're only communicating with your nearest neighbors, if you do two of them, you need information from your diagonal neighbors. And so although this sounds like an attractive thing to do, and in a one-dimensional calculation, it sounds great. In any other 1D calculation, like 2D calculation, you need to get data with your diagonal neighbor. Because if you do two calculations in a row, you need to get this value here. And that value comes from your diagonal neighbor, and that means that that you have to do. Unfortunately, you lose. You think you're doing fewer messages, but in fact you need more messages because you, like in two dimensions, you need to communicate with 8 neighbors, up, down, left, right, and your diagonals. So unfortunately, this is a technique which isn't as easy to use as you might think. The other trick people do is, well, people say, well, actually, if I want to swap depth D every D iterations, I don't have to explicitly communicate with my diagonal neighbors. I can do the standard trick that people do for diagonals is you send a lot of data up the way, and it comes in on the right here. And then on the next iteration, you send this data to the right, and that carries, grabbed slides and not been through them. This is showing the naive implementation where you swap the halo up the way and receive it, and then the next iteration you swap the halo to the right and receive it. But you can see that you don't have the data you need here, this data here, and that requires communication, explicit communication with your diagonal neighbors, which is a bit of a downer. Then you can calculate, and then this is showing that you can do two phases of calculation, one phase and another one, before you have to do the whole thing again. So you need diagonal communications. You must swap halos of depth D-1 on edge IJ. You can do it in 2D, 8 non-blocking sends and 8 non-blocking receives, as opposed to, but in 3 dimensions, you're going to have to use 26 messages as opposed to 6. You can carry the halos, and I thought that's what the diagram showed. It doesn't, but what you can say is that I can swap data up the way and down the way, and then complete that, and then swap data left and right. So the diagonals don't go directly diagonally, but they're carried. They go up the way and then across the way. That is good. It reduces the number of messages. Again, you only have to do four messages in 2 dimensions, or 6 messages in 3 dimensions, a 2D rather than 2 to the D. But the problem there is that then says you have to order them. So basically you're saying, I'm going to swap halos up and down, but I then have to wait for them to complete, because when I swap halos left and right, I'm actually carrying data which came from the up and down halo swaps. And so that has a downside of it as well. It's also quite hard to implement in practice. The reason why it's not so obvious is if you do a one-dimensional example, it all seems great. One-dimensional example, you swap halos of depth 1, depth 2, depth 3, you just communicate with the neighbors left and right, and it all seems to work out great. Unfortunately, it's one of those cases where when you generalize to higher dimensions, it starts to hit you. So I don't know if anyone has any comments on whether they've actually managed to it is a classic thing that I see that people I thought someone was trying to contact me, but they're not. The naive, you have to be careful when you go into these things. And I said, programming a 2D problem, nearest neighbor problem, where you do depth 2 halos or bigger than depth 1 halo swaps is surprisingly difficult to get right technically. It's very easy to get it wrong, and you can put a lot of effort in and not get any benefit. So as I said, the fundamental reason for the naive thinking not having the consequence you might think is that there is no magic in computing. When you send a message, it requires the processor to get involved. And so what you might think is when you have, like, if you've got this much communication and this much calculation, you might think that they overlap. What might actually happen is, no, it goes like that. That you do a bit of communication, do a bit of calculation, and then you affect the process have to go off and do a bit of communication. Then it comes back to a bit more calculation. So the times can sort of, you know, just intermingle with each other. I hope to have that. But is there any does anyone have any comments on that or any other questions they have?
So David, I could if I could share an application. I'm not sure how to do that when you're sharing, but
I'll stop sharing.
Yeah, there's a plot from one of my students' dissertations that where he investigated the effect of increasing halo depth on, and it is actually a one-dimensional problem, which is the easiest one to implement and the easiest one to should be the easiest one to get benefit from.
Is this on the web, or is it a recent one, or is it, because I can just grab
it. It's Previn's one, so it's last year's. I have a copy here, I have the PDF on my screen. But
do you have application sharing? I don't know if I could.
It looks like I'd have to stop sharing and then.
It says you've got application sharing. So application share, you go tools, application sharing, and you click stop sharing, which actually means start sharing.
Okay.
It's very bizarre.
Stop sharing, and then it says some great long message. Okay, I don't want to share my desktop.
You just should click
your desktop or an open application. I want to.
If you if you click, it gives you a list of applications and tools.
That one.
Or you could share entire desktop. It's maybe the simplest thing to do. Okay, something's coming up.
Let's just see if that
there
works.
It is, yeah, okay, I've got it there. Yep, I'm getting a partial, I'm only getting a half.
Oh, right, okay, so it has to be all on the screen.
Oh, that's fine, yeah, I've got it there.
Is that better?
Your Windows, that's it, great, yeah.
Sorry? Is that okay?
Great, yeah, I can see it now.
Good. So, yeah, this is just one of the plots from a dissertation of one of the MSc students here at Edinburgh, where, as part of the work he was doing, he investigated what the effect of increasing the halo depth was, and it's a one-dimensional decomposition code, and you can see that basically there is no effect, there's no significant effect here. There's maybe a couple of seconds difference in the execution time of this particular problem, depending on, so it's exactly the same problem here, it's just the only thing that's changing between these various data points is the size of the halo, and obviously one is the smallest halo that you can do to parallelize the problem. Two is the next choice that you would make, and there is a slight improvement there, and there is all the way up to maybe 10, but it's a couple of seconds on a runtime that is something of the order of 115 or so, and also at around the sort of 100 halo depth, it actually gets worse than at one at halo depth of one. It's not clear from these results that you're actually getting any benefit at all. And it's probably not worth the coding effort to go from one to two.
Was that done on Archer, Danny?
Yeah, this was 512 cores on Archer, with a fairly large problem size. So this is the work buffer is the size of the amount of work that was being done here. So that allows you to have the halo depth up to, you know, quite 5,000. You'd never code 5,000 in a real application. At least partly because of this sort of result, you don't actually get any benefit. So yeah, I just thought I would that's a real investigation on a real machine for a toy problem, but it shows that it's probably not a good idea to try and do this in general. Well, at least this particular problem, it's not a good idea.
So I'm just going to give it, we've had a lot of queries recently about parallel I/O. This is a classic thing people find when they go onto a large system for the first time. If you're running on a relatively small number of processes or cores, you can use a fairly naive I/O strategy and it works for you. But on larger numbers, you can have real issues. And so people start running on thousands, tens of thousands of cores on Archer and their I/O becomes a bottleneck. And what happens is it doesn't degrade gracefully. They get to a, you know, they get to a point where the I/O just the time just rockets. So we put together a sort of a very brief guide to this. I always struggle with multiple. So if you look at the documentation, there's a data management guide. So originally this started out as being information on how to transfer data on and off Archer and how to use the file systems. But I put a little section in here, it seemed like the right place to put it, data management guide, talking about parallel I/O. It's called Configuring the Lustre Work File System. But it just gives you a few kind of ways of sort of, you know, common I/O patterns. But I think the main thing it says is, you know, it's just like if you're going to look at overlapping communication calculation, if you're going to look at writing a hybrid MPI open MP code, it's worth spending a bit of time at the start really thinking hard about whether it's worth it. It's really important to understand if you think your I/O is a bottleneck, you need to understand, first of all, is it a bottleneck? And secondly, what kind of, just because it's a bottleneck doesn't mean you can improve it. I mean, you know, you might say, you know, my drive, my commute to work is my bottleneck in my day. But if you're driving at 70 miles an hour on the motorway all the time, then you can't improve it other than by moving house. So I mean, I talk here about, you know, you need to quantify your I/O, work out what kind of megabyte per second, gigabyte per second I/O rates you're getting. I give a few hints as to what's good and bad I/O, but basically, you know, if you're getting 500 megabytes per second, then you're probably not doing, then you can probably improve on it. The other thing I would say is it's very easy to have parallel I/O in principle in your code, but not realize its performance in practice. So unfortunately on Archer, parallel I/O requires parallelism from the application side. I'm trying to do it. So you need parallelism from the application side, which you might enable with through MPI/IO or using some parallel library like parallel netcdf, but you need parallelism on the file system side, and they're configured independently. So having parallelism on the file system side doesn't help if you've got serial I/O on the application side, but also having parallelism on the application side doesn't help if you've effectively got serial I/O on the file system side, and you need to get both those to work together. So my experimentation, I find that 500 megabytes per second is kind of a quantum, that if you're getting 500 megabytes per second, half a gigabyte a second, it implies that you're getting serial I/O somewhere, and then you have to say, oh, well, I'm not surprised because I'm doing serial I/O, then you, if that's a limiting factor, you have to go to parallel I/O, or you might say, wait, that's surprising. I thought my application was doing parallel I/O. Well, it means that on Archer, you have to then configure the Lustre file system to enable parallel I/O, end-to-end parallel I/O. So that was really, I just point you at that page. We have training material and course material and stuff on this, but it's all a bit detailed. But that was just a sort of a ready reckoner in some sense, just to sort of tell you, to get you sort of up to speed. The only other topic I mentioned in my little preamble in the promo for this session was debugging. Debugging is quite tough, but I would say that we do have, where's the search, DDT, Distributed Debugging Tool, is supported on Archer. So there is a, I went straight to the PDF, I didn't want to do that, sorry. That's not what I wanted to do. Debugging. There is a good section on debugging on the Archer website, and DDT is covered, GDB is covered, must be DDT here. Yeah, so there is a way of using DDT. It's recommended to use a remote client, which is to have DDT running locally and connecting to Azure. So, I mean, again, debugging is tough on a parallel machine. You have a parallel application, so you have multiple processes running, so you need to be able to isolate the behavior of different processes, and tools like DDT allow you to do that. You know, stop half the processes, advance the other half, track this variable on all processes, track it on one. But then you have the mechanics of running, and because Archer is fundamentally the two difficulties are, A, you're running on a machine which isn't your laptop, it's remote, and B, Archer only allows you to run parallel jobs in a batch system. But there are ways around that. So if you want to do debugging, it is quite an investment to learn a debugger. DDT is very good. It's actually written, it's a British product, amazingly. It's someone making money from writing high-performance computing software, their debugger. So it's very well regarded, but it does cost money. So, you know, if you learned DDT on Archer, you couldn't guarantee that you would also be available on your local cluster. If it was, that would be great. It would be a win-win. But also, you have to run in batch. But we have ways of reservation, so an interactive job. So although Archer is a batch system, you do have interactive access if you submit a somewhat strangely called interactive batch job. So that is, so again, there is good documentation there, general documentation, but specific documentation on DDT in section 7 of the of actually the best practice guide. I just Googled for it on the Archer page. So that's definitely worth looking at. So just if there aren't, I said there were two reasons for doing this session. One was just to answer any questions users had, but secondly, we're planning a new course to run at the back end of this year, which is going to be called, the sort of prototype name is Designing Scalable MPI Applications. But the idea of it is it's going to be filling that gap between learning the basic syntax and writing a real application. So it's going to be sort of common problems, the kind of things we've been discussing today, things you learn from experience. Not going to be talking about magic new MPI syntax or new MPI routine. It's going to be saying with the basic toolbox of, you know, send, receive, non-blocking, send, receive, and collectives, you know, what are the best approaches designing and writing real applications. So that's going to be running. I haven't got an exact date, but not to the fourth quarter probably, because it still needs quite a bit of material developed. But we realized that was an area that was lacking. You know, the gap between learning the MPI syntax and writing a real application, trying to fill that gap with practical examples. So that's all I had to say. I don't know if Dan had any anything to add.
No, not really. Yeah, I'm here to answer questions, I think.
Yes, we're happy to take any questions you have, anything at all you have about MPI, really. We're happy to answer questions. Just be around for a few minutes. Please type in if you have anything you want to ask. You can use audio, but it's not always particularly reliable. The chat always works. Always seems to work anyway. Well, if there aren't any other questions, just to thank everyone for attending. It's about an hour, which is sort of the sort of standard time we guess. So thanks, everyone. I'm glad to see the technology seemed to work really well. So goodbye. And as I said, if you come up with any questions after this, which suddenly occur to you, just email the Archer Help Desk. The Archer Help Desk is not just for, you know, I can't log on, or I can't find my files, or how do you do this? You know, we're there. The CST team is there to answer much more general questions that you might have. We won't answer them instantly, obviously, if they're challenging questions. But you know, the help desk is there for any manner of queries or issues you might have, not just day-to-day Archer issues, but more general advice on parallelization and higher-level approaches. We're happy to take those via the help desk. Okay, so if not, say thanks for everyone. Goodbye. Thanks for attending.